We're so glad you're here to worship with us today. Our God is worthy, so we're going to give it all we got. Lift our voices, and let's sing this together. Oh, don't lose heart. Oh, don't lose heart. Oh, my soul, and don't give up. There is hope, there is always hope. There is peace, and there is peace in the storm, no, don't forget. There is a King of glory, there is a God who saves, one who is strong and mighty, freedom is in his name. Open the gates of heaven, lift up a shout of praise. There is a lion roaring, Jesus the King of glory. So lift your eyes, stand in awe, stand in awe. There is one, only one, where my help comes from. So lift your eyes, we say. There is a King of glory, there is a God who saves, one who is strong and mighty, freedom is in his name. Open the gates of heaven, lift up a shout of praise. There is a lion roaring, Jesus the King of glory. Do you believe that today, church? This is our God, and there is no other like him. So we sing this. Nations bow and mountains shake at the sound of just one name, and over all Jesus reigns. I know, I know. Sing that again. Nations bow, mountains shake at the sound of just one name, and over all Jesus reigns. I know. God is the one seated on the throne from beginning to end, the King above all kings and the Lord above all lords, seated in unapproachable light, yet he invites us in through the blood of Jesus. So we come with rejoicing and with praise before our God, and we lift this up and we sing it. Come on. There is a King of glory, there is a God who saves, come on, one who is strong and mighty. Freedom is in his name. Open the gates of heaven, lift up a shout of praise. There is a lion roaring, Jesus the King of glory. There is a lion roaring, Jesus the King of glory. Rejoice in this truth that Jesus is seated on the throne, but we know that he stepped down to stand in our place, to die, that we might be made alive in Christ. And today we lift up that truth by introducing a new song to you that declares that we have been crucified with Christ, but now our life belongs to him.
Oh, be my life. Oh, I surrender, 'cause one day is better with you than all the world. Oh, Spirit of life, help me remember that it is my pleasure to say to you that all I am, my life defined by I've been crucified. Life I live by faith in Jesus Christ who lives in me.
heart grows cold and my flesh is failing. Well, the Spirit is willing to point me back to you. For to live is Christ and to die is better. Help me remember my song to you is all I am. My life defined by I've been crucified with Christ. The life I live by faith in Jesus Christ who lives in me. He is the one who purchased our freedom with his blood, who stood in the gap by dying on a cross in our place that we might be made righteous and right with God. And so we remember all that our God has done and we rejoice. Remember his atoning, his body broken for. Remember his approval, he gave his life to say so. Remember his appealing, my Lord is interceding. Remember if you have my life defined by I've been crucified with Christ. The life I live by faith in Jesus Christ who lives in me. All I am, my life defined by
but he brought me his love for me. His love for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm the child of God. Yes, I am. Realize we see.
His ransom, his grace runs deep.
While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me.
That's right.
Yes, he died for me. The Son sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child.
Yeah.
chosen. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
Sing it again.
I am chosen, not forsaken.
Find our worth and our identity in you and you alone. May you be glorified and magnified in this place this morning. In Jesus' name we all said amen. Amen, amen. You guys can go ahead and have a seat.
Hey everyone, my name is Heather and welcome to Rock Point. If you're a guest with us today, we would love to meet you. Come say hi at the New Here Start Here Center in the courtyard. We would like to give you a gift and help you find your next step here at Rock Point. While you're here with us today, we encourage you to take out your smartphone and type in rockpoint.io. Here you can follow along with the sermon, take notes, keep track of upcoming events, sign up for our We Are Rock Point class, and more.
Every year, Rock Point partners with Compassion Queen Creek to collect non-perishable food items for the people in our community who would otherwise go without. We'd love to collect more food than ever before, and for that, we need your help. On your way out, stop by the table in the courtyard to grab a grocery bag and info card. Fill up the bag with the recommended food items and bring it back here by the weekend of March 1st. It's so easy to help and a great way to show the love of Jesus to the people around us. Visit rockpoint.io, click on the What's Happening tab to learn more and see how else you can get involved.
I'm Angel Magar.
I'm Jason Magar. We're home group leaders for Rock Point. Life is too short to just struggle. If you're feeling alone, you don't have to be. Somebody's in a group waiting for you. One of the hardest things in this world is not being okay to be yourself. And in a group, you're allowed to be yourself. And it's something that supports you. You know, most of us don't have people that we can turn to when we need help, or we need somebody to talk to, or we're just not feeling our best. And the people in our group give us the ability to just talk to them without having to have a mask on or pretend that everything's okay. I can call somebody and say, you know what, I'm not okay today. I need to talk to you.
Home groups really is extended family, and you really do feel like life is easier when you can do it with more and more people who love you. When we walk into church, we can't get in the front door without hugging and saying hello because we've met so many folks through our home group. For us, we're always busy. And so looking for a good time for us to start a home group, if we had waited, we would have never started a home group. And so I would say, you know, pray about it and then just do it.
If you want to try one out, come to ours one Sunday. We'll be more than happy to have you, let you see what one's like. Sign up, join a group, and you'll never regret it.
Our mission here at Rock Point is to point people to Jesus by loving them like Jesus. Thank you for being a part of this by living intentionally and through the faithful giving of your tithes and offering. While we don't receive the offering here in service, we do have boxes near all the exits, both in the worship center and the lobby. You can also give online at rockpoint.io. Let us know if we can help you in any way while you're here with us today, and be sure to connect with us on rockpoint.io and on social media to stay up to date with everything here at Rockpoint.
This is the big service. Come on. You guys got enough sleep? You guys enjoy that rain? Yeah. I'm kind of torn with building a building, as I both love rain, but now it might have slowed down the paving of the parking lot. So that's kind of a bummer. But anyways, but you know, the rain last night actually reminded me of a story. It happened when I was a kid. I was at the baseball field when my dad, we had a game. But then after the game, they came and grabbed my dad and said, we need an umpire for the later game. So I had to stay there for another game, and so I was in like third grade. But there was a couple older kids that we knew, so he goes, hey, you guys go play. You can hang out on the empty field that's not being used, take some batting practice, do whatever. But he said, just one rule as you're running around, stay in the light. You know how the light from the field, it'll bleed out a little bit. He goes, don't go into the dark, just stay in the light, because these were fields that were up above a junior high school. And he goes, just stay here. And so we're playing, hanging out, ball got tossed, it went into the dark, and I ran to get it, and it was kind of an intoxicating feeling to just go into the dark. So I was like, ooh, that was kind of fun. So we started purposely kind of doing it. And then the older kid said, you know what you should do? We've already done it. It's really cool. You should go all the way down to the junior high, all the way down there into the dark, and just go down there and come back. I'm like, really? Go, yeah, you'd be cool if you did it. Well, I want to be cool. So I decided that my plan made more sense than my dad's plans. So I was going to take control of the scenario and be cool. So I took off and I started walking. And I said, I'm going to go all the way to the center. The way the school's laid, I'm going to go all the way to the center where they gate in the little courtyard. And I'm going to go touch the gate. I'm going to get all the way down there. So I was like walking down there, kind of creepy. I felt like, you know, Shaggy and Scooby. Oh, hey, Shag. Hey, Scoob. Zoinkies. You know, as I'm going down. And I get close. I touch the fence. Like, I did it. And right when I touch the fence, I see a flame light up inside the courtyard. I'm like, what is that? I look close, my eyes kind of become clear, and I realized it was high schoolers smoking pot. and they see me, and they're like, hey, kid. One of them goes, hey, kid. I go, what? He goes, stay there. And he gets up and starts walking over. Like, and I don't know what he wanted. Like, he's afraid he's going to get in trouble or whatever, and he's coming at me. And so I was like, zoinkies. And I turn around, and I start running. And as I'm running, he runs and hits the fence. I think he's trying to climb over it to get to me. So I am freaking out, running away as fast as I can. And all I hear behind me is words I'll never forget. He yells out, hey, kid, I know who you are, and I know where you live. And some night on a dark, stormy night, I'm going to come through your window, and I'm going to kill you. Yeah, so I ran back to the light and then was like, and, you know, I learned a lesson in this story about this idea of deciding that my plans made more sense than my father's plans. That I didn't really trust them. I just wanted to do what I wanted to do. I wanted to take control and do that. And that's really kind of the heart of what we're going to talk about today in this Stuck in Idols topic today, where we're talking about these four core idols in Scripture, that every other idol we have comes from that. And remember, idol is defined in Scripture as anything that takes God's place in our heart. God is to be worshipped number one. So anything that you think you need other than God, even if you love God, you love Jesus, but if you're saying, hey, I love Jesus, but the reason I love him is I want this from him. There's something that you really want beyond him is an idol. And so today what we're going to do is talk about the idol of control. And here's the big idea we're going to see. Joy comes from my Savior, not myself. And see, when the idol of control comes from me trying to save myself, get something that I want, be in control of what's happening. And that's what we're really going to unpack. So what I want to do, same thing I did last week when we were talking about power, is I want to define it, describe it, and then talk about how to deal with it. and from Scripture, and we're going to see it from the life of a guy named Peter here in a minute. But first, the definition of how would you define this disciple, so you can see, hey, do I wrestle with this, is I'm only happy when things occur according to my plans and desires. Now, I'm not saying you can't have plans and desires and not be happy when some of them happen. The key word here is only happy, meaning like no matter what's going on in your life, if your plan or your desire hasn't happened yet, then you can't really have joy. You're frustrated, you're not there, it's not until this happens. In other words, one of the things that's hard to identify the idol of control in your life is it disguises itself as competency, organization, being on top of it. Many people with this as their idol get promoted. They're called a leader. Oftentimes, they're a get-it-done kind of person. Now, I'm not saying any of those are wrong. I would hope I have at least one of those traits, being the leader of this church, but the reality is it's not the action itself, it's the attitude, it's which places it in your heart. Is the goal of your life and the drive of your life is to accomplish your plan. And if that is number one above God, it's now an idol. In other words, if lack of organization and consistency disrupts your God-given joy or makes you actually question God's sovereignty, you know, the type like you want details, you want to know how it's working, you have a plan, and when it gets disrupted, your whole life just kind of has a meltdown. Like you have a plan for your kids, and when that plan isn't working right, do you stop working, basically? Does it paralyze you? That's kind of what it's describing. So, what are some identifying questions to try to further just describe this a little bit? There's three things that they're more like statements, like qualifiers than questions as much, but fill in the blank here. I will be truly content or happy when? Here's the thing, if you have a control issue, you probably had an answer by the end of that phrase. You already, and if you had a quick answer that it wasn't like just trust in Jesus and embracing his love, I know there's certain things I would like to have happen, but you know what, I know I'm okay if I have the love of God, then that's okay. But if you had an instant answer, that I know that there's that thing you're chasing, that thing that you're after, and you really are never truly happy or content without it, that's a good indicator. Another way of saying it is the second phrase here, the second fill in the blank. It's life only has meaning, I only have worth, if I'm able to get mastery over my life in. That's a common one. Like, you know what? I will have meaning and worth when I finally lose that 20 pounds, when I finally get that job, when I finish this, when I get that relationship, when this happens. You know, that thing that you're chasing after, and I'm not saying you don't have plans, but I'm saying is you actually feel like you are not a complete person, you're not really there, you're not worthy until you get this. You're like, I will have meaning when I've mastered being a parent and my kid is perfect, and then you think you got it, and then you have another kid. And you realize, oh, I'm not the perfect parent as you're blogging about it because you have a four-year-old that hasn't rebelled against you yet. And then you tell everyone, no, here's how you're the perfect parent. I did this schedule and did this and this and this and this and this and this and this. And like I said, have another kid. And then have a third one. And then you'll question your whole life. Some of you are crazier and keep going. I don't get it. Another way to say it is this last one, a little bit different. Do I say that's not fair a lot? Now, I know we're not kids, so most of you don't walk around literally saying that all the time. You don't sit there like your kids, you're at work, boss gives somebody an increase that you think you deserve. You don't sit there and be, but that's not fair! But you said it in here. How often are you saying that's not fair in here? How often are you seeing someone else get something that you desired and you have planned towards, and you don't think they deserved it because they weren't as on top of it as you are, and now you're mad at God, you're inside, like your whole life, some of us, our whole life is one big chip on our shoulder about what we thought we should have got and we didn't, even though we tried everything, and you're mad all the time. So you're like, that's not fair. You're always worried about the fairness of life because you think you deserve something. You had a plan. Your plan got thwarted. It's like that's not fair. It's like when you wife say to your husband, I'm gonna start eating better, and he goes, you know what, I'll join you. And he lost 10 pounds by the end of that sentence. And then you're like, that's not fair. And he lost another 5. See, now you know what I'm talking about, right? So that's really kind of these questions help you go, do I? Because, like I said, this is the easiest one. This is the one that if you have this problem, you're usually the last one to know. And so what are some of the actions then? The actions of, or first, not the actions. Let me go to the biggest fear of somebody with a control issue is uncertainty. It's uncertainty. And you want to be certain about everything. You want to know everything. For example, I've seen that, you guys like personality profiles? Enneagram? Anyone just?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, see? Always the youngins, man. Here's the thing. They're great. Personality tests are great. They really are. We use them on our lead team. We use them with our teams and stuff, and they're great. But can I just tell you something? There is an indicator. I've noticed some people that have control issues get freakishly hyper into personality profiles. Like they describe you, but they don't define you. And I've seen that people that have control, they say you have a tendency to get hyper into it. Like, that's all you talk about. You're like, oh, yeah, I guess I'm just a 7. That just explains it. You're you're a 3. That's a 4. All your talk starts to become this language. Some of you are, what are you talking about? Anyone who knows the Enneagram knows what I'm talking about. And then you want to, and you know why? Because you have to have certainty. So you are so into these tests because I need to be absolutely certain about who I am, and I want to have great justification for why I do the dumb things I do. Well, yeah, it's just because I'm a 7. I'm a this. And you want to be able to classify everyone around you. You want to be able to know. That's why you get hyper. They're not bad things, but if you are obsessively into it, you might have a control issue. And you're probably trying to figure out what I am. I'm a 7 wing 8, which means I'm spontaneous. It's where the woo and the waha and the fun comes from. The 8 is where the throat punches come from, okay? So there you go. You can now classify me too. But it just kind of works that way. And so that's kind of like, because you want certainty. If you're someone that every time they're like, someone friends, hey, or your spouse goes, hey, we're going to go to this thing next week. When is it? What time is it? When do we have to leave? How are we supposed to dress? Now, you should ask these things, but then you're like, how long do we have to stay? Who's going to be there? What's going to be the topic? What are we eating? What's going to, and you get freakishly nitpicky about everything. You may think it's just that you like to be organized. The issue is you might just like to be in control. You need certainty because that's become your idol, because that's how you find joy, is being in control. The most common emotional struggle with that is worry and anxiety. Because think about it. A person that has a control issue thinks they can actually control issues. And here, you seem to be the last person on the planet to realize the only thing that we humans can actually control is nothing. You really have no, you can exercise all you want, but you have no control over when you die. I mean, it might help you live healthier, you might live longer, you might not. So I only exercise so I can eat more food. I let one addiction balance out the other. And I do that on purpose. I fight them against. It's a political thing. As long as they're fighting each other, I have balance in the force. But see, so it's this, and so what happens with that is you get worried because you can't control and you try to control. And then people around you often feel condemned. When you really have, and they might not say it to your face, but they feel like you judged them. Like they see you watching you do something and then, Or they say, oh, you're gonna do it that way? We call that a mother-in-law, but I say that every service. My mother-in-law is amazing. I'm just assuming that's your guys' problem, not mine. So, and you keep laughing, so it must be. But yeah, they feel, and the price that you're willing to pay if you get really, really controlling, is loneliness. Because you'll be so into what you need to control that you might end up losing out on relationships. I am such a fitness freak that's beyond, it's a control thing now. It's not just be healthy, that I can't go out, I can't do this, I can't eat. Nobody wants to invite you to a party because you're going to worry about what they have for food and you're going to feel judged when they talk about their keto, whatever, caveman diet they're eating that week. I'm on the seafood diet. I see food, I eat it. So there you go. But I got to get up at 3 a.m. because I got to go do this. And I'm not saying that happens on the discipline is if you want to be an athlete. But if it's like, do you really need this for your life? But you have to do it, and you're missing out on relationships. At that point, it might be about something more than just fitness, or sport, or whatever it is. I saw people, there's always a trend going through the church on parenting models. And it's funny how all of them, none of them just stick to scripture, but there's always, every generation, there's a different parenting model battle. And I will see parents dig in to over this and basically alienate family and friends and everything over something like, why do you care? Go ahead and raise your kids that way. But why do you have to argue with everyone around you about it? Because you're worried and you have anxiety that I need to be right because I need my kids to be right. And I need to raise them right. And then by the time you're a grandparent, you just don't care anymore. Trust me, I know. Does that make sense? That's kind of describing it. So what we're realizing here is when you really dig down in, control is really a trust issue. You see, control doesn't flow from love. Control flows from fear. Fear, it's a response. Control is a response to fear. When I have fear, I try to take control. I mean, think about it. Every time you get in a big fight at home, it's like sometimes it's like you finally get really heated because you're fearful that you're wrong, you're fearful this is right. So you try to manhandle the situation. As a parent, you try to take absolute control. As a boss, you try to take control. And it's usually in response to fear. Well, love always results in trust. So that's how we need to unpackage this thing. So if I have this issue, if I've kind of made control my idol, what does that look like as a Christian? What does it look like? How do I lose control? And what I want to look at is the life of the disciple named Peter. He was a friend of Jesus. He's one of the 12. He became the leader of the disciples after Jesus was resurrected. But he got there the hard way, like we all do. He had to grow. He had to grow through his issues. And I think, that's what we're going to look at, I know he was very impulsive, but I think some of his impulsivity was also driven by his control, because I think we can see it in here. And where we're going to start out is in Matthew 26. Last week on power, I showed you how the disciples were dumb enough to start arguing about who's the greatest at the Last Supper, when Jesus was saying, I'm going to die and all that, and then they get in this argument. This happens right after that. So they got done with the Last Supper, so they even sang a hymn. They sang their closing song, and then they walk out, and then this happens. So here we go. It says, verse 31 in Matthew 26, on the way, Jesus told them, tonight, all of you will desert me. Well, that's a good conversation, huh? He's like, tonight, you all desert me. For scripture says, God will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. Verse 32, but after I've been raised from the dead, I'll go ahead of you to Galilee and meet you there. So Jesus is so cool because he's like, you're all going to scatter. You're going to freak out because I keep telling you I'm going to die, but you still don't get it because you think that's a bad plan because you think that surrender and sacrifice is losing, but I'm actually going to win. I am God. I will raise from the dead. But in that process of me getting tried and put to death, you guys are going to freak out and scatter. But he goes, but I get it. I know what's going to happen. I'll meet you in Galilee. When you guys calm down and realize I came back, we'll get together then. Well, look what Peter says. Peter declared, I declare, even if everyone else deserts you, I will never desert you. What? Jesus just said, all of you will. Yeah, they will. Not me. You and me, Jesus. I got a plan, and I will not leave you. Now, if that's not crazy enough that here he is, God of the universe, you've watched him do everything he said he's going to do. He already said, one of you is going to betray me. And they're like, what? And then Judas leaves the room. And so now he says, now you're all going to leave me. And he's like, why does he think he says no? Fear. He doesn't want to be a failure. He doesn't want, so he's like, no, Jesus, there is no way. No way. So then look, Jesus gets even more specific. He goes, verse 34, Jesus replied, I tell you the truth, Peter, this very night, before the rooster crows, you'll deny three times that you even know me. So now he gives them absolute specifics of how it's going to work out. And look what Peter says. No, Peter insisted. Even if I have to die with you, I will never deny you. So now he one-ups it. He goes, not only will I not deny you, I'll die with you. I have no problem with believing that you're going to get arrested and killed. I have no problem believing when you said you're going to come back to life. But you know what I don't trust you on? Is you don't know me as well as I know me. And I don't trust you on your plan for me. because my plan is better. My plan involves me dying for you. And that brings me joy, because joy is found in me, not you. Think about the audacity he had to say that. Think about the reason. If you're a control person, if he was and knew back then, he might have said, there's no way I'll deny you, Jesus. I'm a 6 on the Enneagram test. I'm a loyalist. I can't possibly deny you. That's just not who the Enneagram says I am. And I trust that more than you. Think about that. Think about the boldness in doing that, that he just doesn't believe Jesus. Maybe you do that. That you'll trust God on everything else, but when it comes to the plans in your life, you're not going to trust him. You think you know what you need better than he does, or what's going to happen better than he does. So what do we need to do with this first point here, if we're acting this way? If you're like, Jesus, you might know everything, but you don't know me. What do I need to do? Well, I think the first step is I need to choose to approach my plans with open hands instead of closed fists. As you make plans, like I said, planning is not bad. It's talking to God, saying, here's where I want to head. Here's what I think is going to happen. That's okay. But when you have a plan in your life, when you have ideas and stuff, you need to hold them like this. See, God, it says in the book of James that it says, you know, don't say, I'm going to go to such and such a town and do business for so long, or whatever it says. You should say, the Lord willing. So it's not saying you don't make a plan. You don't have ideas. But the first part of planning in your life needs to be, but God, I hold it like this. Meaning, if it doesn't happen, I'm not going to lose it. I'm not going to deny your sovereignty. I'm not going to think you hate me. I'm not going to just go into a tailspin of depression. I might be disappointed, but at least I'll see what's going on. Around here, we actually have a phrase with our creative process on the team here. We call it, we plan so we can pivot. Because sometimes God just changes plans. Sometimes things just happen. And we can't get so consumed with our plan that we hold it like this. For example, this whole series, where we're going, we went on a retreat, I told you, months and months and months ago, and I had a team of people that worked all day to map out and help me come up with content, and we had this entire series mapped out, and then a week before we launched this series, I said, I think I've been studying, I've been praying, I've been looking deeper, I think we need to dive deeper into this. I think our crowd can handle this. I think we need to dive to the heart and the root of it, and you know what? They were all okay with it, because if you're a control person, you wouldn't last 10 minutes on this team, because that would have just made you melt down. Some of you said, yeah, you changed it last minute after months. Your heart rate started going up. And that's kind of how we need to be with God. We need to go, hey, here's my plan. But some of us, we act like Peter did. He didn't hold his plan like this. He was like, I don't care what you say, God. I'm holding on. My plan is I'm not denying you. I'm doing it this way. You don't understand. Matter of fact, my plan even goes deeper. I not only won't deny you, I'll die for you. But what's funny is, He says, I won't deny you while denying him. You get that? He's like, I would never deny you. I just won't believe you. Well, what's the difference? I won't trust you. I'm not going to believe you. And when you hold closed fists, what does it look like? It looks like old-timey boxing. That's what it looks like. But you know how we do it as Christians? We don't directly say, I'm fighting with God. Here's how we do it. We go put our prayer hands on, and then we do this. Lord, here's what you're going to do. You're going to fix this. You're going to do that. You're going to do this. And I'm going to keep saying this till I get it, or I'm going to walk away from you because you can't be God if you don't do what I tell you to do. Does that make sense? Think about your prayers. We do share our heart with God. You can request things. You can pray for miracles. I'm not denying any of that. The difference is not when you do that. The difference is when you pray over the plan. You pray for it like this and say, but as Jesus prayed in the garden, but not my will, thy will be done? Or do you pray, my will or I will be done? Only you know the answer. But that's the first thing. But then the next thing is, not only I need to do that, the plans I do bring to the Lord when I request and make plans in my life and requests and all that, I need to align my plans with God's priorities. Meaning what I do try to bring always needs to align with God's word. I can't say I'm believing in Jesus, trusting Jesus, and then what I'm going after in life has nothing to do with God's priorities for my life. We're called as a Christian. If you're a Christian, the priority in life is to point people to Jesus by loving them like Jesus. It's to be in a relationship with Jesus where you know, you grow, and you go. And that's your priority. Jobs are things we do. We can do that through our jobs and our careers and being parents and all that. But to glorify God in our lives is your number one call. Do you actually align the plans of your life around that number one call? Or do you try to sprinkle Jesus into what you really want to be doing? Because that doesn't work that way. Peter goes on. He doesn't align, even when he hears what God says. His plan to even not deny Jesus. So here he is. He's trying to serve Jesus, but he's actually not listening to Jesus. The very next thing he does when they go to arrest Jesus, it says he takes a sword out and lops a guy's ear off. And Jesus says, stop that. Don't you even realize that you think you're saving me? You're trying to stop because your plan is to not let anything happen to me, but you don't get it. I'm supposed to die. You're going to deny the whole plan, and guess what? And you don't think that if this wasn't the plan, if I didn't want to die, I could call down in a second, 1,000 angels would lay waste to this whole scenario. So I don't need you to protect me. Your plan is literally contradicting my very plan. But yet you're doing it because you don't want to deny me. And then it gets worse. Look what he does. After that, he still doesn't get it. If you go to verse 69, this is where it starts to happen, what Jesus said. You're going to deny you even know me 3 times. So now he's been arrested. Peter has followed him. They've gone into this courtyard where they're starting to try him. And Peter snuck in there because he figures if I stay close to Jesus, I'm not denying. I haven't abandoned him. I haven't left. I'm staying close to him. I'm not actually listening to him, but I'm trying to be close to him. And so as he gets in there, he's watching. And all of a sudden they notice, hey, I think this guy's with Jesus. And so it says, meanwhile, Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. A servant girl came over and said to him, you are one of those with Jesus the Galilean. But Peter denied it in front of everyone. I don't know what you're talking about. Watch the progression of how he denies. The first one, he doesn't actually say, I don't know him. He doesn't literally deny Jesus. He just tells her, you don't know what you're talking about. It's a little distorted kind of truth. That's where it starts with us. When control is our idol, we'll say we want to be close to Jesus, but we'll slowly stop actually listening to Jesus. We'll slowly start justifying things that aren't his priority for our life. And we'll say, wait, and if you get called out, you don't know what you're talking about. Your first thing, you said if I know Jesus, I should know, grow, go. I should be involved. My life should be wrapped around the priorities, meaning my time, my talent, my treasure, my goals should be wrapped around what God wants to do in this world. But I know I'm not totally doing that because you don't know what you're talking about. That's where it starts. Yet you still come to church. So before he's trying to be close to Jesus, but he's dismantling his character, and he's not following the priorities of God. Do you do that? Do you sit in here week after week and absolutely ignore God's priority for what you should be doing with your life? But you want to be in here. You want to be like Peter. I want to see Jesus. I want to feel like I haven't abandoned him because I'm still showing up. So I'll stay close, but I won't actually listen to him. That's what he's doing. And when you start down that path, when you start to have your plans stop aligning with God's priorities, it takes you further down the road. Because look what happens next. Later, out by the gate, another servant girl knows him and said to those standing around, this man was who was with Jesus of Nazareth. Again, Peter denied it. This time with an oath. I don't even know the man, he said. Now he makes an oath. An oath in scripture is a big deal. God says, don't make oaths. And if you do, you better make sure you keep it. So he makes a solemn oath and then flat out lies. Now he went from this subtle, you don't know what you're talking about, to an oath that's contradictory right out the gate. And here's what's funny is, this is only a few hours after. I mean, he's had an hour between. We know from the other gospels it's been an hour from the first denial to the second. Don't you think if Jesus said 3 times you're going to deny me, now he's done it twice, wouldn't he, even in that hour that he waited after, wouldn't his conscience, wouldn't he start to say, Jesus said I was going to do this. Why didn't he figure that out? Because that's the insidious nature of control. If you have this idol, you're really good at justifying. You're really good at deflecting. You're really good at not seeing it. Because what he probably was thinking was, when he heard Jesus say, you're going to deny me, he thought completely abandon him and leave. So everyone else scattered, but he didn't. So he probably didn't even see what he was doing as a denial. That's like I show up at church every week. Oh yeah, there's things I don't honor God with that are obvious in my life. I'm a Christian and I won't trust him with my family. I won't trust him with my marriage. I won't trust him with my relationships. I won't trust him with my work. I won't trust him with my money. I won't trust him with my time. Whatever it is that you are obviously not trusting, you don't see it because you're like, I love Jesus, I'm here every week. Or every fifth or sixth week, as long as the schedule allows. And if you say I should totally trust him, that's not fair. Because you don't know what you're talking about. I'll make an oath. I'm going to do it this way. Because I'm holding my plans like this, and I'm not aligning my plans with God's will. And it just takes you down a road. Because it gets even worse. A little later, some of the other bystanders came over to Peter and said, you must be one of them. We can tell by your Galilean accent. I wonder what a Galilean accent was like. Is it like the southern accent? Howdy, y'all. I'm from Galilee. Probably not. But Peter swore. Now he's swearing. A curse on me if I'm lying. I don't know the man. And immediately, the rooster crowed. In Luke, it tells us that as that rooster crowed, he was close to Jesus. Close enough that says Jesus turned and looked at him. Faced it. They saw each other. They were close enough to get eye contact. Well, I am uncomfortably giving some of you right now. Like, stop looking at me for so long. It's creepy. He knows my soul. And it says Peter wept bitterly. Man, what kind of a look was that? I don't think it was the look you give your kids in the rearview mirror when they just won't shut up. It's not that. I think it was a sad look. Sad for himself, because even though he is God, he goes, yeah, you're going to desert me, you're going to abandon me, and I'll meet you in Galilee. And then Peter says, no way, and he goes, yeah, you're going to do it three times, and then it happened. Jesus knows what's on the other side of it, but still is in his human nature. These were his friends. He's gone through a stressful night. He knows what's ahead. I think it was a sad look. Sad that you broke my heart, but sad for Peter because he goes, I know I'm going to get you through this, but I'm sad for you that you had to do it this way. The same way when we grieve the Holy Spirit in our lives. He loves us anyways, but it breaks his heart. You realize when we sin and don't trust God, it's not so much about I tried to speed and get away with it. You didn't just break a law. The sadness about not trusting God is you broke his heart because He's your heavenly Father. He made you. He wants joy for you, but he also knows how that works. And when I don't listen to him, it breaks his heart. And that broke Peter's heart when he saw the face of Jesus, because it came all together. Oh my. I had a very different plan than Jesus did. And he fought it. Well, we know that Peter took this very hard. He went away when the disciples were together. They're all back in Galilee. He got sick of waiting, and he just basically said, I'm going fishing. I'm going back to what I used to do. I'm just going to go be a fisherman again. That's a lot of us do. When we have control issues, and we just won't do it, and finally we break, we kind of go away, and we're like, I'll just go back to what I was. And Peter goes back. Well, then Jesus shows up on the shoreline, invites him to go over, and he has this weird response. He's kind of intrigued. He jumps in the water. He swims to him because he's impulsive too, and he gets there. But yet he's close to Jesus, but now he feels like not worthy to be around Jesus, which is another instinct of control people. If you're control people, tend to be perfectionists because they tend to make it about them. It's about me getting my thing done. It's the heart of legalism. And so a control person, when they fail enough, they implode. And you know it. When you failed a lot, you just feel like you're a loser, and you have these moments where you just want to quit. And that's where he is. And what does Jesus do? He has a conversation with him on the shoreline here that absolutely restores Peter. Peter's not perfect yet, we'll see. But he restores him. But how does he do it? Does he do it with, you shouldn't have done that, you shouldn't have done that? He restores him by asking three questions. Three times he denied him, three questions. And all three are about love. You see, we need to approach our plans open-handed. We need to align our plans with God's priorities. And then the last thing is how you can continue to even do this is, like I said, control comes from fear. You attack fear by relying on love. That's the third point. You need to attack fear by relying on love. What do I mean by that? Attack with love? You attack fear? Yeah. In 1 John, it says, true love casts out all fear. It's the love of God. When I embrace the love that Jesus has in me, and I understand how he loves me so much, I can attack, I can toss out, cast out the fears that make me want to control. And cast out is a term, we think of fighting fear as like a warm blanket on a cold, windy night. Okay, it's the wind's still hitting me, but at least I'm able to hide under here. No, he says true love casts it out. That's an aggressive term. That's like a term where a bouncer grabs an unruly patron by the scuff of his shirt and just drags him out and tosses him out. He's like, you ain't welcome here anymore. Get out. We are supposed to not just withstand fear, we're supposed to go on the offensive. We need to take it to fear. You need to attack it. And how you attack it is with love. You need to embrace the love. And that's what Jesus does here with Peter. Look what he does. It's in John. This is in John chapter 21. It starts in verse 15. It says, after breakfast, which is a little side note, if you're going to have a tough talk with a man, make sure his stomach's full first. After breakfast, Jesus didn't have bacon. That's important. Although they didn't have bacon. After breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Now, it's interesting. In there's multiple words for love, so this is even deeper when you hear it in the Greek, because there's different words for love. So Jesus says, do you love me? And he uses the word agape, which is described as the love of God, or it's described as a very selfless, sacrificial love. It's basically kind of the love that Peter was declaring to Jesus when he said, I will never deny you. Matter of fact, I would die for you. I agape you. And so he goes, do you agape me? Like you acted like you did. And Peter says, yes, Lord, Peter replied, you know I love you. He uses the word phileo, which we get Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. Phileo is the Greek word that means brotherly love, means I'm highly fond of you. It's a really good, deep love, but it's not agape. So it's interesting that Jesus says, do you agape me like you were claiming before? And Peter doesn't feel worthy, knows, hey, maybe a little humbled, whatever. He's like, nah, I guess I just am really, really fond of you because I chickened out. But then look what he says. Then feed my lambs. He didn't make him say agape back. He just says, I get it. You're struggling with this. You don't feel worthy to say agape because as a control freak who failed, you now feel like a failure. But you need to know my love for you. I died for you. I came back. And I'm telling you, I'm inviting you to be on the team. And what does he invite him to do? Get back on mission with him. Do the mission. Feed the lambs. So then he asks a second time. Simon, son of John, do you love me? Do you agape me? Yes, Lord, Peter said. You know I phileo you. Then take care of my sheep. A third time he asked, Simon, son of John, do you love me? The third time Jesus said, do you phileo me? Jesus flips it. Says, do you love me like a brother? And Peter said, first it said he was hurt that Jesus asked the question the third time. I think he was hurt because of the way he switched it. And then he said, Lord, you know everything. Which, what did he say in the beginning of this whole story? You know everything, but you don't know me. Now you keep asking me these questions. You said, do you agape? I said, yes, I phileo. You agape? I said, do you phileo me? You already know everything. I'm going to answer honestly. I'm not going to lie. And he says, you know that I phileo you. Now here's what's crazy. I have to admit, this is a good example if you deal with this issue, because I had to deal with this last night. Yesterday, my brain had a little minor implosion. And I said to the sermon yesterday, the services, that the third time Peter said, you know I love you, I said he said agape. I was wrong. But I found out about it because someone in a small group went to our small group's pastor who's there in this group and told him, because they actually read their Bible and apparently have their Greek New Testament with them at church. And he came and pointed it out to me. And I said, really? Get those people out of this church. I don't need people noticing my heresy. No, I was like, thank you. And I go, where did I get that? What was I doing? How did I switch that in my head? And so then I went home in true control person fashion, and fixated on that most of the night. I was like, I blew it. And then fear. And you know what it was? Where I got, well, other people are going to notice that. They're going to leave the church. I'm a false teacher. I'm a heretic. They're going to, you know, it's terrible. You know, I'm going to, you know, whatever. And I was just worried about it. And as I was fixating on this, I heard the voice of the Lord basically in my own conscience say, Bill, do you agape me? I was so upset that I blew it, Jesus. I blew it. I taught wrong. I messed up that I got fixated on that. And then, but he goes, listen, Peter's kept saying, I phileo. He messed up. And I kept saying, feed my lambs, take care of my sheep. You got to preach tomorrow. Trust me. So I'm admitting I blew it. But you know what? It's a great commercial to get in a home group, because apparently you'll learn the word of God better. You'll outpace me. But also, you can trust me on this point, because I applied it last night. And I leaned into the love. And all those fears went away. So it works. And you know what? My point I made was accurate, because it makes more sense. Because he said, then feed my sheep. And then verse 18, he says, I tell you the truth. When you were young, you were able to do as you liked. You dressed yourself and went wherever you wanted to go. But when you're old, you will stretch out your hands and others will dress you and take you where you don't want to go. He was being a very vague way of telling him you're going to die. But what he's saying is, yeah, you keep saying only phileo because you don't feel you can say agape because of how you failed. But he goes, don't worry, you're going to get there. And you are going to die because of your faith in me. You're going to die with me. And when he said stretch out your hands, you're going to be crucified. It even says here that Jesus said this to let him know by what kind of death he would glorify God. And then he told him, follow me. So he says, you're right. You're not, okay, I get it. You keep saying phileo because you feel inadequate, but you're going to get there. So keep on mission. Keep trusting me. Basically, follow me, and that's how you're going to get there. And you will eventually die and live up to what you said you wanted to be in the beginning of this story. Well, here's why you know this is where it's so beautiful to know how loving Jesus is and how patient he is with us. Because right after he tells them that, it says that Peter turned around and saw behind them the disciple Jesus loved, which is John's term for himself in his letter because he didn't want to be proud and share his own name. So instead he says he's the one whom Jesus loved. Maybe that's just stick it to the other disciples. I don't know about their fight on who's the best. But he says that, and then he turns, he looks at him, and then he points out to Jesus. He goes, Lord, he asked, what about him? So when he says, you will die, you're going to get there, you're going to die, you're going to be crucified, and he looks and sees John, he goes, well, what about him? In other words, right in the middle of this whole thing about learning to just follow Jesus and trust him and don't be controlling and hold your plans like this, not like this, and make sure your plans are aligned with following me, and then realizing that it's love, cast out fear, you can trust me, you should love me, and he finally admits that, and then he says, and you will die for me. Really? Wait, that's not fair. That's what he's saying. He immediately started to go back to the same way. And then Jesus answered him. He says, if I want him, meaning John, to remain alive until I return, what's that to you? As for you, follow me. And you know what? He did. He got it. If you look when he's older, 1 Peter chapter 5, he's now an older man. This is right not long before he does die for his faith. And he's writing to young leaders, young men who are like himself in the story we just read. And he tells them this, humble yourselves under the mighty power of God, and at the right time, he will lift you up in honor. Give all your worries and your cares to God, for he cares about you. He loves you. He knows you better than you know you. Stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Stand firm against him. He's saying there's a liar that's going to try to twist and scare you and twist your faith into taking control. So in the end, you have to lean into God's love. And like I said at night when I was on the baseball field and went in the dark, I learned a lesson. I didn't learn the lesson that night either, just like Peter didn't totally learn the lesson that night. I learned it months and months later when I was sitting, because every time it was a dark and stormy night now, Because I went back, I didn't tell my dad. I blew it. I didn't want him to be mad at me. I didn't trust. I didn't want him to know. So I still stuck to my own plans. I'm not going to tell him. I'll just deal with it. And how I dealt with it was worry, anxiety, fear. Man, I had a big tree outside my window. Every time it was a stormy night, lightning would go. It looked like someone with a bat, you know. And then, or the wind would blow, and it would, like, start screeching up against my window, and I thought someone was trying to get in. I would double-check the locks on my window. I would leave the light on. I would fight my parents on going to bed. They would go to bed. I'd turn the light back on. I put a baseball bat under my bed because I thought I might have to deal with this myself. And all I had was anxiety, fear, and bad sleep on stormy nights. So finally, my dad knows after a few months. He comes in. He goes, "What's going on? You're acting weird, and I know you. There's something going on. You got to be honest with me." So I finally just, I fessed up. I told him, this kid yelled, he's going to kill me. And he goes, "Son, why wouldn't you tell me?" Because the reason I told you to stay in the light is because I didn't want things like this to happen to you. You realize I wasn't trying to ruin your life. I wasn't trying to stop you from experiencing joy. I was trying to give you the pathway to joy. So you should have come to me. And then after it happened, you should have come to me. Because by hiding it and keeping trying to take this on yourself in the fear, you started to believe lies, which is exactly what we do. We believe more lies, which causes more control, which makes more fear. And he said, "Like, what do you mean I believe lies?" He goes, "So this kid said he knew who you are, right? What name did he call you?" Because he just said, "Kid." "Have you ever seen him before?" "No." I go, "He lied to you. If he knew your name, he would have said your name. He has no idea who you are. So you got more fear and took more control because you believed this lie." And then he goes, thirdly, he leaned it all tenderly. He goes, "You really need to understand this, son. I was in three wars. I've actually had to kill men on dark, stormy nights." He's like, "So, don't you think I could protect you from some punk high schoolers? Why would you be? They should be afraid of me. And you should have listened to me." But then lastly, he said this. "But more important than that is even if something came in here and it could kill me, I would die so you could escape. You know I love you that much that I would lay down my life so that you could have one." That fear left me. Lickety split. Slept like a baby. The love cast out the fear. My dad showed me what Jesus is like in that moment. He has plans for you. Follow him because he does love you. He'll protect you. He knows you more than you know yourself. And in the end, he laid down his life so you can have a life. And if you keep taking control, there is something off in your understanding of his love for you. Could you just embrace that? Humble yourself, as Peter said. Come clean. So will you stand? Just stand, and we're going to sing our theme song for this series, "My Worth Is Not Found in What I Own." And what I mean by own, it's not just the things. It might be the control you're owning, the plans you're owning, your ideas you're owning, your own perception of yourself that you're owning. And maybe we need to understand that joy is found in my Savior, not myself. And so make the words of this song maybe the cry of your heart to confess and just surrender to the love of Jesus. Amen? Let's sing.
Skill or name, in when or lose.
rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure and wellspring of my soul. And I will trust in him, no other. My soul is satisfied in him alone. As summer flowers, we fade and die. Fame, youth, and but life eternal calls to us at the cross. I will not boast. I will not boast in wealth or might or human wisdom's fleeting light. But I will boast in knowing Christ. And I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. And I will trust in him, no other. My soul is satisfied in him. And I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. And I will trust in him, no other. My soul is satisfied in him alone. In him alone. In him alone. I confess my worth and my unworthiness, my value fixed, my ransom paid at the cross. I rejoice, and I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. And I will trust in him, no other. My soul is satisfied in him alone. My soul is satisfied in him alone. You is the cry of our hearts. Be the satisfaction of our souls like no other, God. May we not try to take control, but Lord, may we trust in your plan, in your sovereignty, in your goodness, and in your love. God, we put our trust in you. Lead us through this week, God, that we're heading into. May we surrender the idol of control, God, to your love, to your will, to your plans and purpose. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for being so good to us, God. It's in Jesus' name.